Call the Airport Commission Board Meeting of May 28th, 2015 to order. All rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Harold, can you do the roll call?
I'll be doing the roll calls tonight. So Commissioner Sonio?
Here.
Commissioner Fors?
Here.
Commissioner Munoz?
Here.
Commissioner Purvis?
Here.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Present.
Commissioner Zenko?
Here.
Chair McGregor?
Okay, so the first item we have is Kimley Horn and Associates Professional Service Agreement Number 2, Design of Electrical Improvements and the Development of a Pavement Maintenance and Management Program. You want to bring us up to speed, Brett?
Actually, we're at the minute approval first, and then we can move on to the...
That's a good idea. Yeah, I like that. Okay. Are there any changes or corrections to the minute? Additions from the board? Seeing none, nothing from the Business Association. I'd consider a motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded to accept the minutes as written. All in favor?
Not.
We have
to do it. We'll do a roll call.
Who seconded?
Sue.
Oh, Purvis, okay. All right, roll call. Commissioner Sonio?
Yes.
Commissioner Fors?
Yes.
Commissioner Munoz?
Yes.
Commissioner Purvis?
Yes.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Yes.
Commissioner Zenko?
Aye.
And Chair McGregor's absent.
Okay, moving on to considerations for Kimley Horn and Associates Incorporated Professional Services Agreement Amendment Number 2, Design of Electrical, Airport Electrical Improvements, and the Development of a Pavement Maintenance and Management Program.
Okay, so this item, if we recall at last month's meeting, we brought the initial application for federal funds to the commission last month, and the commission approved the application for and the acceptance of, actually made the recommendation for the item to move on to city council. Those two items for the grant are the pavement maintenance management program and the airfield electrical upgrades in short. This process that we're going through tonight is actually to have Kimley Horn and Associates, who is our consultant on retainer, to actually conduct the work. We would like to be able to conduct the work, but we are not expert in designing projects and doing studies on pavement maintenance and management programs. So this is why the FAA recommends you go forward and select a consultant and put them on retainer, so that way we can accomplish the work. Just to give the commission and the public some background information on this, in 2014, we executed the master agreement with Kimley Horn and Associates and the city of Salinas. This is a retainer type of agreement. The retainer doesn't hold us to doing anything with Kimley Horn. It's when the work comes available and the funds come available that we can actually initiate work. So we have Kimley Horn and Associates on retainer. And the retainer is a three-year agreement with 2 one-year options. So at the end of 3 years, we can express whether we want to enter those 2 one-year agreements. So it also holds Kimley Horn to performing on what it is that they're getting paid for. If we don't like the product that they're providing us, we don't have to continue on with the contract. In fact, at any point in time, if we don't want to have Kimley Horn and Associates do work, we don't have to enter into any contracts. But we've been very fortunate with the relationship with Kimley Horn and Associates. They're very well respected within the industry, and they actually do good work for us. So as a city entity, we're interested in moving forward and entering this new agreement. So this is amendment number two. Amendment number one was the airport layout plan update, which is underway with Kimley Horn Associates and Kaufman Associates. That was also executed in 2014. And now as new funds become available and the project is ready to go or ready to get moving with those funds that are available, we're looking to move forward with amendment number two of their agreement, which is design of airport electrical improvements and the pavement maintenance and management program. If you recall on the grant that we're applying for, which is essentially our entitlement funds, which the FAA provides to us each year is $150,000. We intend on using all $150,000 on the two projects that we're asking Kimley Horn Associates to move forward with. There is a 10% match, so we can expect to spend $15,000 on the match of $150,000. So only $15,000 comes from the Airport Enterprise Fund. And again, no funds come from the general fund. And for the viewers that are watching this online or on TV, the airport is an enterprise fund. We don't draw any monies from the general fund. Every dollar that we make through our rents and other fees is what we expend to run the airport. And in your package that we provided you, the airfield electrical component of this project will cost about $75,000, and the pavement maintenance and management program will cost about $90,000. And on all grants, the FAA requires us to do an independent fee estimate. Sorry, I just did abbreviated IFE, but that's independent fee estimate. This means that we will go out to another consultant of sorts and ask them to provide us an estimate on what they anticipate the work would cost. And they need to come within anywhere 2% to 10% of what it is that Kimley Horn Associates is proposing. Otherwise, the FAA will then get involved and ask questions as to why Kimley Horn Associates is charging too much or charging too little. So this is kind of the balancing act to make sure that we're getting the most bang for our buck. This project, which will commonly be referred to as AIP 24, this is how the FAA will identify this grant. It will be AIP 24. And so as we move forward, in short, instead of saying the airport electrical upgrades and the PMMP, we will just in short probably start referring to it as AIP 24 as in whole. So the electrical design includes airfield signage, runway 13 reels, runway 31 PAPI replacement, wind cone upgrades, vault equipment upgrades, and taxiway Bravo LED lights. As you can see, most of these improvements, we're looking to, again, cut our bottom line and go to more energy efficient equipment, which will help us save money in the short term and long term. And then the pavement maintenance and management program, PMMP. In short, it's Kimley Horn will conduct surveys, inspecting visually and structurally the pavements at the airfield. They'll develop a pavement rehabilitation and strengthening option program for us. They'll also prioritize the rehabilitation and put it into phasing so that way when we go to the FAA, we have sound data as to why it is we're asking to reconstruct pavements on the airport. And then they will also work with us in the city and integrate the program with our city GIS program. So I have Bob from Kimley Horn Associates, and he's going to speak to you in a minute about more of the program in detail. But before I have Bob come up, the one thing that I want the commission to understand with the pavement maintenance and management program is that the FAA requires any airport sponsor moving forward that is looking to accept or apply for grants for pavement projects to have a current PMMP in place. And so this way, they know why it is that they're giving you the funds to reconstruct your pavement. So it's a necessary evil to spend money to be able to get money in the future. It's no different than having a current airport layout plan and a master plan, so that way we can apply for other dollars in the future. And with that, I'd like to introduce Bob from Kimley Horn Associates, so maybe he can go in a little bit more detail as to what it is that we will be undertaking.
Good evening. My name is Bob Hamilton, as Brad had mentioned, from Kimley Horn. And I'm going to start with the pavement management stuff. And as Brett said, the pavement management is kind of like an ALP for pavement. The FAA does require the pavement management program to be in place with a PCI index to show the conditions of pavement before you can apply to have funds to do rehabilitate pavements. And you guys all should have a pretty colorful map right there, 11 by 17. That's an example of what a PCI index looks like. It rates it pretty much from 100 down to zero. So some of the new pavements, like Taxiway Alpha and Charlotte, were done recently, should be in the green near 100, and Taxiway Bravo, which was done recently as well, should be higher up there. But some of the older pavements may rank lower on the scale. And this, how this index is created, is a combination of field observation and some coring. I think about 20%. You divide the airfield into certain areas, and then 20% of those areas get random cores to take to look at the asphalt depth and the underlying conditions below the asphalt. And then based on the field observations and the coring, all that information is input into a program. We use a program called MicroPaver, and then also using some of the design aircraft will come out with a PCI ranking for the current asphalts, and then it can also kind of project how those PCI indexes will rate 5 or 10 years from now based on continual use or projected use. And with that, we can come up with a recommendation for how to rehabilitate the pavement. If it's really bad, you may end up looking at full depth reconstruction, but if it's in relatively good shape, you can get away with like a mill, an overlay, or something similar to that, which is probably a little bit more cost effective. And then as far as the electrical work, as part of the Taxiway Alpha and Charlie work that was done last year and a half, the edge lights were upgraded to LED lights. So part of this design is upgrading the Taxiway Bravo edge lights to LED lights. And with that, it requires some replacement of some regulators in the electrical vault. And what that does, as Brad had mentioned, is you're able, with the LED lights, since they use less electricity, you're able to downsize the regulators, which reduces electrical costs for the airport and helps with the bottom line. Some of the other things that we're also looking at is the FAA had come out with a new advisory circular for wind cones, so those need to be upgraded and replaced. And then there's some additional signage that we're looking at replacing in some areas where it's not there or needs to be adjusted or corrected based on some of the RSAT surveys from the FAA. And finally, the reels and the PAPI, those after a certain amount of years, the manufacturers either stop supporting the reels, like not just reels of PAPIs, but a lot of like signage and runway lights like that, and it's harder to get replacement parts. So usually the FAA would just rather you upgrade the equipment so that you can maintain it better rather than have to deal with trying to find parts that aren't made anymore, aren't supported anymore by the manufacturers. So those are some of the things that we're looking at as far as what will be put into the electrical design and then eventually into construction documents that will go out to bid. And the reels and the PAPI, I mean, they would require some runway closures, but typically that's done at night and when it has less effect on the users, and it's not like every night. It's probably they can do a lot of the work in, you know, a couple of weeks as far as inside the RSA to minimize the amount of downtime for the runways, for the runway. Any questions?
Commissioner Sonio.
So the 86 to 100 is like excellent. If I'm looking at the reading on the chart, and if you move the picture over, the one right there on the right-hand side, that very top number, that would be like excellent?
Yeah.
Right. So then looking at the color and the entire map, looks like we're sitting pretty good, because most everything seems to be at least above 50% and better.
This was an example. This was done at we did this at Dallas Love Field.
Oh, this is not our
airport. So
this is
a map that we'll be creating for Salinas, which will look similar to this. But as you mentioned, you will see a lot of green on there because Taxiway Alpha and Charlie were just recently done, and Taxiway Bravo was done like 3 or 4 years ago. So those areas will be higher on the index, where maybe some of the runways or other taxiways will end up a little lower on the chart.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Purvis.
Do you know when the last time that this was done, we had this kind of analysis?
I do not know. I do not know off the top of my head when it was done.
I believe it was prior to 2010. It's been a while, and that's a very conservative number. I know that we have a plan, but it's not as comprehensive as what it is that Kimley and Horne Associates will be doing now. The FAA has come up with new guidance as to what needs to be in the pavement maintenance and management program, and so we'll be collecting that data and putting it into the plan.
Any further questions from commissioners? I know that when we did the last paving, I'd hear from people, pilots and non-pilots, going, wow, they keep paving it. You'd think that everything's great. And without the analysis, you wouldn't know that what's underneath is giving out and failing. And I would think that before you get down to the gray area, or when you get down to the gray area, you've got clumps of material coming up that can damage engines and props. So this is great to see. We're staying ahead of this. Commissioner Zanko.
I just had a technical question for you on behind the scenes electrical, and you speak to about regulators. I assume what you're saying is that you cannot see or realize the savings from the LED fixtures until the support electrical equipment is changed out.
Yeah. I believe that there is some savings right now, but with the reduction in the regulators, it increases the savings.
Savings.
I could probably get more details from our electrical team on exactly if they can ballpark exactly what the estimate would be.
We've worked with the electrical component of Kimley Horn and Associates over the last year when we had Taxiway Alpha and Charlie LED lights put in. And we are at max savings with the equipment that we have now, and it's barely nothing. If we were able to adjust our regulators, we would be able to see savings, but they are non-adjustable. They're just old regulators that pump out the same current no matter what it is that they're using. So with these improvements, we'll then be able to have them adjusted, or they will automatically adjust to the load that's demanded.
One reason Bob gave was the obsolescence of the equipment. I was working on some taxiway lighting over in Monterey and called up to order some parts. And the technician goes, well, let me see. I'll have to see if I have that part on the shelf. That's kind of old. So I told him, well, I'll make it real simple for you. You go back to the shelf, get every part that fits this equipment, send it to us, we'll buy it, and we'll be set for a little while, because if we don't get it now, we may not get it when we need it. We did that, so I know they're cleaned out on that particular type of regulator. And being able to adjust them, yeah, you've got to be able to set them for different light levels, but you can only go down. You have parasitic loads in a regulator, so if you can go to a smaller transformer, you waste less just from idling.
Thank you.
Commissioner Munoz, good to see you back.
Are we going to be looking alternatives for saving energy, maybe using solar panels?
Currently, right now, the airport has solar panels being installed in the parking lot, and I have an update on that, which we will be talking about in a minute.
Do we have any more questions from the board for Bob? Do we have any questions from the public? Seeing none, let's move on.
So with that, there is a recommendation in, it's actually on the agenda, what we're looking for the commission to advance the item to City Council.
Yes, so I'd look for a motion to approve.
I'll move to approve. Two.
Commissioner Zanko, move to approve. Commissioner Osonio, second.
Can I sneak a question in here? Because about the actual agreement. I believe it says something like it could take up to a year to get this done. I don't remember where I read this, but we wanted to have it done by March. Is that true?
By March of 2016, are you referring to?
Yes.
Yeah.
I guess it is about a year, not quite.
Just a little under. A note for the commission, the reason why we don't have City Attorney Callahan here for the agreement is because this is the same agreement that we'd move in front of the commission when we did amendment number one. And so nothing has changed within that amendment other than changing dates, and then we added the scope of work as an attachment. So it's everything remains the same except the dates pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, we've got a motion and a second, and if there's any discussion that we need to talk about with this particular motion, seeing none, I'll call for a roll call vote.
Commissioner Sonio?
Yes.
Commissioner Forrest?
Yes.
Commissioner Munoz?
Yes.
Commissioner Purvis?
Yes.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Yes.
Commissioner Zanko?
Aye.
And McGregor is absent. Thank you, Bob.
We'll move on to administrative reports. We've got our fuel flowage report.
We have the fuel flowage, what you can see in April of 2015, we had 7,000 gallons pumped of 100 low lead, and then 31,000 gallons of Jet A. I think we're missing some running totals on 2014 and 2013, but right now the numbers are looking—they're looking fine. They're no different really than last month as we're tracking. What we will see is next month we hope to see a peak or a spike, I should say, with 100 low lead and Jet A sales because of the AOPA fly-in, and then the same with operations. Operations were trending better than we were last year, but slightly lower than 2013. So. It's better. We're doing good. We'll also see a spike in May because of the AOPA fly-in.
Commissioner Purvis.
I remember I was talking about this a few months ago, but I kind of did my own running totals, and Jet A is way down from how it has been running. We ever get an answer out of Jet West?
No, Jet West hasn't. Ryan hasn't provided me an answer. I mean, it's just the way the business is trending. So, The one thing that I will say is I'd like to see us. I thought that we had them the running totals for 2014 and 2013, so we can compare them from year to year. We'll make sure that those are put on there next month.
Any further questions on fuel flowage? Seeing none, let's still, we had a question about energy-related improvements to the city facility. Bring us up to speed, Brett.
Yeah, we actually had some movement. As of today, we had column foundations set, and what's going to happen is there's going to be, it's going to look like 3 weeks of nothing happening, but everything's kind of happening in the background, getting the electrical, which is underground and set up over by the terminal building, being set up so that way when the solar panels come in and they can plug them in, they're ready to go. We expect the shade port structure to be installed sometime late June. We're just waiting for those confirmations. We know some steel is coming in this weekend. It's just when they're ready to start erecting it. Just to kind of give you an idea of what it looks like in the parking lot. So the picture off to the left is an individual column that's being poured. They auger down about 8 feet, and they put a steel cage in there, and some of them have grounding wires go down into them. You can see in the right-hand picture, it's just the row for the shade ports for the columns. This is looking down into one. And this is the crew actually pouring them. So the columns, the shade ports run left to right in an east-west orientation. And that is the update. Any questions?
So this is the parking lot in front of Jet West?
That's correct, and in front of the terminal. So you can see the terminal off to the right-hand side. I don't know if I can do, I don't know if the laser won't work.
Are you going to do the whole parking lot like they did over at the Monterey County Office of Education?
There's two rows of shade ports that run east-west, and they're the most center parking rows. So you won't have anything extending on the edges. It just wound up better from a design standpoint, making sure that we had adequate clearances for the fire apparatuses or large vehicles coming in and out of the frontage streets in front of the terminal and by Jet West.
And the solar panels are going to operate the terminal building, Jet West?
So the way this program works is we have 20 meters on the airport that run everything from our terminal to facilities that we lease out, that we own but lease out, to hangars, to the runway lights. We're able to kind of combine those into one single account, and the solar panels offset the entire account. So I don't believe that this will be a net zero for us, but it will offset quite a bit. The solar companies believe that we can easily run the terminal building and Jet West and 240 Mortensen off of just this bank of solar panels. So there's plenty of supply.
And then what's the payback time? How many years?
So the finance period for the overall program, which is a citywide program, is 15 or 17 years. It was 15. I think they switched it to 17. Is that correct, Commissioner Zenko? 17?
Well, to my knowledge, it is, yeah.
17?
Yeah.
Okay. 17 years is the payback. So the savings that are rendered from the install of solar panels will pay back for the investment, which is essentially the installment of all of the city saving, the energy saving devices throughout the city. So we have all of the street lights that were installed throughout the city. We have four or five other solar panels or photovoltaic panels going up throughout the city, which includes the Permit Center, Sherwood Hall, the airport, and the industrial wastewater facility over off of Hitchcock Road. So did I miss one? Is that all of them? I think that's all of them. And then there's also further savings that we'll be moving forward with next month, and that has to do with HVAC, so the heating and air conditioning system. Some components will be replaced in the terminal so that way we can see savings. We have a lot of old equipment that sits on top of the terminal building. And I don't know the entire list for all of the other city facilities that will be having HVAC installed. There's also LED lights that are being installed in some facilities, LED lights within office spaces. I don't know if they're doing in here and other city facilities, so it's a complete project, and the payback is for the entire project.
Commissioner Purvis? Yeah.
You want to go first? Go ahead.
Just for clarity, I work part-time assisting Gary Peterson from a project management standpoint on that, and I just wanted to clarify that and bring that forward so everyone's aware of that, but I'm not working specifically on anything for the airport in that regard. This project has a lot of components to it, and if you have questions specifically on what the scope is, you should really refer to, I think, the October 21st council meeting is where the energy services contract with Optera was brought forward for consideration with the council, and it encompasses all of the background pro forma, the financials, for anyone that wants the details of this thing and how it pays out, all of by year, you can see all of the data in the pro forma for this for 20 years. It has the contract documents and everything attached to the staff report. So if anyone is interested, to go to the city website, October 21st council report agenda, and you can bring that up.
And I believe we did discuss this more in depth about 2 months ago when I brought forward that we were going to be installing solar panels, and I had the exhibit and the schematic for the actual install. I actually inserted a bunch of language from that city council meeting into the presentation. So,
Commissioner Purvis.
Yeah, I see from the picture there that there is a fence around the parking lot, and it looks like they're digging right in the middle of the lines. So is the parking lot going to be cut off from use for a while, and are we going to have to redraw the lines around the posts?
No, the install is actually it conforms to the actual layout of the parking lot. The fence is just a temporary construction fence that'll be brought down. There are still two rows of parking, which is the furthest south parking row right along the terminal building, and then the furthest north one, which is right behind me. I'm actually on the other side of the fence taking the picture, so there's an entire row over there. We also have street parking in front of the terminal, and then we have street parking along Mortensen Avenue, and then also on Skyway. So I haven't noticed too much of a problem. And I also did forget we do have parking right in front of Jet West on the street, and then right in front of 240 Mortensen. So I don't think that we've had any capacity issues yet. So it hasn't been a problem.
Do you know what the diameter of those posts are gonna be?
I don't know offhand, but I could let you know. 2 feet.
I was going to say, by looking at the picture,
I can find out and let you know. I can actually even go out there and measure. And we have the schematics, and I can pull up the diameter of the post, but it won't actually affect. This is a very common install that they've done all throughout. I think they've done a couple installs throughout the city already. So,
any further questions? Okay, well. Let's go. We had a big event here on May 16th. You want to fill us in, Brett? How did that go?
I'm about to astound you on some things. It's really impressive. These numbers alone are the most impressive numbers that I received from AOPA. If you recall, just in the magazine spread that AOPA did on behalf of the Salinas fly-in, If you were to take the dollar value and you wanted to go to AOPA and ask them for one page spread in their AOPA pilot magazine, it's $14,000 per page. And so all of the printed material alone is over $100,000 just in printed material, that if I wanted that same marketing, I'd have to go spend $100,000 just to get that marketing. But then I wouldn't have an event if I just did just the marketing alone. You know, the event comes along with all this marketing that they did. And then I actually threw in a rough number. I didn't get the number from AOPA. It was probably $50,000 in video production marketing. When you take When you understand that they had a film crew come out to the airport for 2-3 days and just take footage of the airport, and then the amount of time it took for them to compile that and put in, I think it was about a 3-minute, 4-minute video. They did two or three different videos. They had one just for the fly-in, then they had one for Yuishi, the aerobatic performer. It's well over $150,000 that was just spent in advertising and promoting the airport. When I first brought this event to the commission, this is one of the things that I was most excited about, knowing that this was going to happen, that they had to promote the event. No matter if the weather was good, bad, or indifferent, the promotion was going to happen. So over $150,000 in promotion. The AOPA economic direct impact, these numbers don't seem as high when you compare it to $100,000 in just printed material marketing, but this is direct impact to our businesses. So the landing zone catered 325 meals, and on days that sometimes it's slow at the airport, they had 60 dine-in customers just dining in. They also did, they sold several meals outside. They had a little barbecue spread that they put up, and so there was meals in addition to that that they didn't even count into this number. JetWest sold 3,500 gallons in 100 low lead and 1,000 gallons in Jet A that just wouldn't otherwise have been there. There was 100 rental cars that were ridden from the airport, which again, JetWest does get a percentage of that. And just a statistic, they did 50% fuel orders for every fly-in attendee. They may have been 5-10 gallons, but they handled it beautifully with how many fuel orders they had to manage. There was 3,000 total attendees, 330 fly-in aircraft, 895 automobiles. There was, I believe, over 100 exhibitors, 9 food trucks, and tower operations Saturday alone was 1,300 operations. And a normal day, if you take our normal day operation and divide it out, it's 166. Pretty impressive when you think of, I don't know if you were on the radio listening to people coming in and going out. I was very proud of our air traffic control tower. There were many doubts coming from the aviation community, and they handled it. They did well. And so I don't have anything negative to say about that. In this picture, you can see just how busy it was. This was the display area where you can see the tents. And I think I have another picture with some more display areas. All the aircraft are static displays right up here in front on the concrete area. And then you can see all the aircraft that are flying in that are parked in the background over there. Those are the Saturday attendees. I have 53 campers. We had another 150, almost 200 aircraft just sitting on the other side of the airport off of Taxiway Delta and Taxiway Papa. Taxiway Papa, if you recall, is where we put all the campers, and we shuttled them over to the main event. The only complaint the campers had was it was cold. So this is our parking lot, and this was midday. This was before the 895 vehicles, but all throughout the day we had people coming and going. It's actually quite difficult to get a really finite number as to how many people are coming in, because they're always coming and going. There was about 20 RVs that were camping out in the parking lot, and you can kind of see them off to the top hand left. There was RVs all packed up there together. We had some tenants come on the airport, and they camped out just so that way they could be on hand to volunteer early in the morning. And again, 9 food trucks. One of the things that actually really caught me off guard was that Congressman Farr presented us a congressional record in honoring the AOPA fly-in. And so if anyone wants to see that, that's in the office. There's the full text in there. He quoted Jeff Mitchell from the Salinas and discussed the importance of the event and what it is that they're looking forward, what he's looking forward to in the future for aviation. And what I'm going to do here next is there's quite a bit of photos. Most of these photos are from the AOPA photographer, and it's just I put together a slideshow so we can kind of enjoy the fruits of our labor, what it is that we did. But he really captured, we really tried to capture the spirit of the event. So if you want to sit back and enjoy, this will play just for a minute or so.
Like that Ford Trimotor?
Mm-hmm.
AOPA has expressed deep gratitude for the airport's ability to host this event. We really put together a good team. The tenants, the businesses were very passionate and energetic about this. It's been the only thing anyone's wanted to talk about for the last month at the airport as we ramp up to it and prepare for it. AOPA has expressed that we have set the bar very high as they move forward, and as they move forward, as they move on to their next fly-ins. We did a lot of groundwork for them. We invested a lot of time in ensuring that we were ready for the capacity. We were ready from a safety standpoint, from an emergency response standpoint, from an attendee customer satisfaction standpoint. We really tried to address every single issue along the way. We learned some things from AOPA, and AOPA walked away amazed at the caliber of personnel that are either on airport staff or volunteers for the air show, or whether they're businesses or tenants. We delivered, and we delivered well. That was very intentional. We tried to make it as easy as possible, knowing that hopefully they'll come back. Hopefully they'll come back in 2-3 years, and that was what our goal was. And we left a good taste in their mouth. So for everyone that helped participate, I know Lori and the 99s, Earl, the commissioners, thank you. Anyone that's watching this on TV that helped, we were extremely pleased with how this came out.
Commissioner Purvis.
I know I was pretty apprehensive about having to park 500 airplanes at our airport, and I was so impressed with how everything ran. They did a really good job.
I've got to say that the tower operator getting the planes out when I was working it was the best I've heard. He was great. And I got a great compliment from the Ford Trimotor volunteers who go around with the Ford. the end of the event, they said, you know, this has been really a pleasant place to work. And I go, well, it's all like this everywhere you go, isn't it? And she goes, oh, no, no, no. Most volunteers are coerced into showing up, and they're not really happy, and they're not always pleasant. So that felt good to know that we were up there. If we have no more questions, then we can move on to what's happening in the future. We've got the Tenant Appreciation Day coming up. Brett, you want to fill us in?
Yes, so the last item, Tenant Appreciation Day. And again, we're a very unique airport where we really try to build community within the airport. And so this is a day out of the year that we can honor the tenants, those who make the airport viable, those who actually pay into the system to make the airport continue to run, so that way we don't have to use monies from the general fund to operate the airport. So it's a day that we set aside, and it's just a bunch of fun activities that we involve the tenants with. So it's on June 27th out at the airport. It's open to pretty much anyone that wants to come. We will have a guest speaker, which is the author and writer, Barbara Schultz. She will be doing a presentation on the flying carpet, which has to do with, his name escapes me now.
Aladdin.
No, not Aladdin.
Halliburton.
Halliburton and Moore, is it Maury? Moy Stevens, and it's their trip around the world, and it's a great presentation. We had her out for an EAA event last year. And she was just, the stories are phenomenal. It's a good presentation. Our honoree of the year is none other than Commissioner Jim Shoemaker. We have our flying competition, which we hope to be putting out the line, the spot landing line early this year. I mean, really early. We want to try and get it out 2 weeks in advance. So that means in about 2 weeks we should have that spot landing line out for the tenants to go out and start practicing. And then we want to put the flower bomb drop target out early, so then the tenants can actually go and practice early, and we're going to be working with SOPA to make that happen. We'll coordinate some time, some windows that we can be out there, and make sure that the flower bombs aren't landing on the air, on the runway. Then we will have lunch served at the airport, and then we're still working on the inter-airport competition, where we invite all of the other local airports to come and compete against our best flyers. So we're not only trying to build some community amongst our own tenants, we're trying to build community amongst other airports. And, you know, very similar to what it is that AOPA does. They want to give the pilots a reason to fly. So we're trying to give pilots a reason to fly, and why not come over to Salinas and fly and give us some operations. So that is our Tenant Appreciation Day. Nothing has changed since last month, and we won't be speaking about this until after it's already happened. So,
well, this will be another great event, and we're looking forward to it. I'm wondering now if anybody has any announcements. Commissioner Purvis?
I don't have an announcement, I have a question.
Okay, this is a good time.
What's the status of the roundabout?
Roundabout is, it's moving forward. I'm going to provide an update on that next month, but they have done some very, very minor work out there as of recent. They relocated a utility pole into the parking lot. I'll be getting with James Serrano next week and get a full update as to when we can expect construction to start, because we want to send notices out to all of the tenants and users of the airport so they know when traffic will be affected. So,
Commissioner Osonio, did you have something?
Yes, it's not airport
related.
Can you
use the microphone?
Yes, I do. It's not airport related, but this weekend is the Artichoke Festival, 56th annual. It's now at the Monterey County Fairgrounds, all day Saturday, all day Sunday, and I will be in the fry booth all day Sunday working. So, come on out.
Oh, that sounds great. No other announcements. I do have an announcement. The EAA 204 local chapter here in Salinas will be again having a speaker. Our speaker this coming Thursday, a week from tonight, is Alan Brown. He's considered the father of stealth technology. He was the design director at the Skunk Works and designed the F-117, and also has worked on the SR-71. So he is an extremely interesting speaker, especially if you're interested in stealth technology or anything aviation related. So that'll be 7 o'clock at the airport terminal, June 4th, this next Thursday.
And for anyone that's watching this on the broadcast, anyone is welcome to come. If you're interested in aviation or if just the presentation sounds interesting, feel free to come into the airport and in the terminal building.
Yes, very much. We want everybody out there. And we'd like to open it up now for general public comments. Are there any comments from the public, questions for agenda?
My name is Lars Freeberg, and as a local business owner, my father and I own Salinas Valley Ford. And I just want, I've never been to one of these commission meetings. I don't know anybody on the commission. I don't know anybody at the airport. But I want to compliment the commission and the city and the airport for this event. I did not personally know about this event until that day. We were having a large car show at our dealership. We've been doing it for 6 years. Last year, we had over 200 classic cars at our dealership. People come from a good distance, San Luis Obispo, up in the northern Bay Area. And this year, we only had 100. And so I started asking people, and there was a lot of people that went to this event. And so I just wanted to provide some feedback from the community and to compliment everybody involved on it. I think it's a great thing, and there are a lot of assets that this city should use to improve this city, and I just wanted to say I think it's a great idea, and I would actually like to know what I can do or what my business can do in the future to support that. So I just wanted to compliment. It's a good thing for the city, so thank you.
Thank you, Lars, and I might mention that the reason you didn't know is because it wasn't advertised to the general public,
okay.
Because this is the AOPA,
right.
Is their payback to the members, and so they didn't want the public to come in thinking they were going to see an air show, because unless you're really interested in all these gadgets, it's not as interesting.
I'm interested in airplanes, but I understand, I know the AOPA, and I have a little flying experience, but again, in the future, if there's anything a local business owner can do, I want to support what you did, so because I know it's good for the city, and again, it only benefits the city, and it benefits me as a business owner to help that feedback. I'm not saying sell cars there, I'm saying to get people to love this city again and more.
Great. And you know, one of the highlights for me at the air show was the Ford Tri-Motor. Henry Ford developed a lot. He did a lot of aviation development.
Right.
He didn't keep good records, so we don't know how much he spent, but he spent a fortune into aviation. Developed the Tri-Motor as the first cross-country airplane.
Right.
And you might be interested in getting involved with that when we sponsor that next.
Yeah. No, we were all having our fun, and all of a sudden the sound, and we saw it fly right over the dealership, and everybody just stopped for a minute. So it was, I think it was a great event.
It's good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lori, would you like to address? Oh, I'm sorry.
I would just like to thank Brett for pursuing this. I've got to say I was a little concerned when you initially threw it out there, and I thought, oh no, would we be prepared to handle it? But Brett worked night and day and put so much effort into this, and you made it happen, so we appreciate it. It was a big benefit for everybody. That being said, I just want to comment, there was an editorial in the Salinas Californian last week that would lead some people to believe that the airport is funded from the city and the general fund. And as Brett mentioned earlier this evening, it is operated from an enterprise fund. It is self-supporting, and it does give back to the community. And some of the ideas that came about are certainly things that were looked at from past commission meetings during past airport master plans and found to be not possible for one reason or another. And so they aren't ideas that are new. They are ideas that have been looked at, and the commission and the city council have decided that they aren't the best option for the airport. And I would just like to thank our commissioners and our airport managers for making sure that the airport is managed so well. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. That sums it up for me, too. I know we looked at those things Jeff has talked about, and I do see empty hangars when I go to other airports like Stockton or Monterey that tried to overdevelop. And especially appreciate the work that Brett put into this and bringing it to the city when we're all going, are we ready for something this big? If we have no further business, the airport commission meeting is now closed.